Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The following are lessons which Sheikh Nuh gave at the first North American Siyaha of the Hashemiya Darqawiya order of the Tariqa Shadhiliya, which took place in Herndon, Virginia from January 2nd to the 4th, 1998.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
The people of Ascription to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the people who have taken the tariq, and I'm not speaking only of this tariq, but rather the Naqshbandis, the people who have taken any real tariq that is connected with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by rijal, shaykh from shaykh from shaykh from shaykh from shaykh from the Sahaba, from Hassan to Ali, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who have a lineal connected concatenous chain back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Any of those people are the people of Nisba. They're the Ahlullah, the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so they're the people whose ibadah, what they're really trying to achieve, what they're trying to gain, is Allah Himself. Okay, so, you know, none of the other Hawashi is going to go up and kick the favorite courtier in the knee. You know, why? Because he's the king's favorite. Okay, similarly, من عاد لي وليا فقد أذنته بالحرب. Okay, of all of the people, of all of the things in the created universe that Allah, that is between the Kaf and Noon, that is in this Kaun, of all of the things that is in the created universe, Allah has chosen certain to be mukallafin, to be morally responsible, to have the option to win unto Jannah, to win unto Paradise. Or on the other hand, to disregard the warnings of the prophets and to go to hell. Okay, so merely honoring that Allah has honored them. So we show respect to every human being because of that fact. Because the wheel is still in spin. Okay, the wheel is still in spin. And somebody who's at the bottom of the wheel is going to be at the top at the next moment. You know, because it's still going around. Okay. And we're at one point, and then the other people are at the other point. We don't know how it's going to turn out. Okay? Allah could turn us into an atheist. He could send us a trial that would knock the iman out of us. And turn us into atheists, wa na'udhu billah. Turn us into the people that don't understand anything except particles bumping into each other. He could turn us, if he wanted to, into man worshippers, into Christians. Wa na'udhu billah. He could take away this iman that has been given to us. Okay, we don't want it to be taken away. What is the sabab for the blessings are not taken away? Thanks. Gratitude towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why the people term gratitude, the ulama term gratitude, they say it's the sayd al-mafqood wa qayd al-mawjood. It's the way of hunting blessings that you do not yet have, that you hope to attain. Okay, by thanking Allah for the part of them that you have. Allah will increase them. And it's the hunting of the absent, Sayyid al-Mafqood, wa Qayd al-Mawjood. And it is the tying, the shackling, the manacling of the blessings that one has, that which exists, or that which one has. So we respect all people because we don't know that Allah could make that person a wali, and He could make you someone ta'ban, someone in a destitute condition, someone in a lamentable condition. Okay. But more than this, we receive the believers. It's strange, and I've remarked upon this, and it's worthy that we understand that the way that the tremendous imams of tasawwuf, such as Sheikh Muhyiddin ibn al-Arabi and the other imams, they have a special nadra. They have a special way of looking at believers. Believers are the acme of existence. Believers of the jinn and of mankind. They are at the peak of existence. Okay, they are the reason, the manifestation of the sharia is the reason why the universe has been created. We mentioned this and we talked about this last year. How that the mulk, the world of that we see, the phenomenal realities that we see, exist through the spiritual world, Because the attributes, divine attributes manifested by phenomenal realities can only be manifest in their fullest and most complete extent against the backdrop of eternal felicity or eternal perdition, as we mentioned yesterday. And the spiritual world, in turn, exists through the absolute presence, the absolute oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the worlds, the lower worlds to the higher worlds exist, the ones that are closer to us exist, the ones that are farther from our reality. So in this world, the world of, world of Mulk, Adam and Mulk, the highest thing are the believers. Okay, so at the end, the great Sufis, the great Imams of Tasawwuf, have a special way of looking towards anyone who has ever said La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah. And I encourage myself, so I'm saying this, and all of you, anyone who hears these words, to have the same opinion. You can't say, well, the Muslims, that miserable Muslim, he opened up a whiskey store over in Southside Chicago or something. What a dirtbag. True. You know, we have to have, one of the marks of Iman is Hubfillah, or Bughfillah, to have love for the sake of Allah and hatred, detestation for the sake of Allah. But we don't hate individual people, nor do we love individual people. Okay, we love them or hate them, according to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of the attribute that is found in them, the attribute. Now, the fact that this person has opened up a whiskey store over there, that's why we hate them. If it, you know, it's just like, you know, it's nothing personal. Okay, there's nothing personal except our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the only thing that's personal. Everything else are just merely the manifestations of Allah, including all other people. Okay, the manifestations of Rahmah, of the great things that Allah has created. And we have to have ta'zim bima adham Allah. Okay, we have to show reverence towards the things that Allah has raised. We have to raise and show veneration for the things that Allah has raised and made high in this world. Okay, of the highest of them is the Iman. Okay, so this man adali wali fakad adantuhu bil harb, as we mentioned yesterday, you have to understand it. Whoever shows enmity to a friend of mine, I declare war against. And there's nothing that's as terrible as this. This wording, I declare war against, this hadith of Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fighting such a person, and who's going to win, in parentheses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has only mentioned in this hadith of Qudsi, the war of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against two kinds of people. Those who harm and offend the awliya first, and those who take riba, usury, interest. Okay, so we have to be careful of these two things, very careful. Find out what they entail and avoid them. Okay, if we want to keep our heads on our shoulders with the king, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so we show respect. You know, this is one of the greatest of the adab. We show respect to all believers, anyone who has said la ilaha illallah. And in reality, the adab of the tariqah means you show respect to every single thing that Allah has created, because all of it is a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَظَاهِرَ الْحَقِّ لَا تُعَدُّ وَبَاطِنُ رَبِّ لَا تُحَدُّ لَا يُحَدُّ. It's part of the qasida. I don't know if it's our Shaykh's qasida or not. He says the manifestations of al-haq, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, literally the real, are innumerable, are infinite. The manifestations, the ways in which Allah has manifested Himself, are limitless, are innumerable, infinite in principle. He said, "And the inward of my Lord is illimitable." It is something else. The whole tariq may be said to elucidate this latter point, and so I won't dwell on it. Okay. So we have to have respect towards all other people. And we have to have, but in particular, of the awliya, ahl nisbah. Okay, the people who have taken the tariq. They're ahl Allah. They're people who are, they're not interested in palaces, and they're not interested in hurul ayn, and they're not interested in other things in the next life, but rather, as Rabia al-Adawiyah said, she says, well, how come you discount Jannah? You know, she says, well, my principle is, Al-Jar, Thumma Dar. It's the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's, look to the neighbor first. Okay, when you want to buy real estate, what do you look for? Do you look at this wonderful house? It has curb appeal. It has, you know, all this stuff. No, you look at who the neighbors are. That's the most important thing. Because if you have a bad neighbor that's always bugging you and that's always, you know, I remember, subhanAllah, Allah yatub alayna, when I was a little kid, We used to practice archery in our backyard, and I couldn't figure out where the arrows were going. You know, sometimes we'd miss an arrow, you know, we had the target propped up against the hedge. And was it Mrs. Reiser was the one who's next door? Anyway, we went and, you know, let an arrow fly, and it disappeared. I went over, and there it was, you know, sticking in her door. Oh, no. You know, so, you know, she opened the door, you know, as we were trying to pull out the arrow. And she handed me about six others. And so, you know, you have to be good neighbors. You know, so. The jars and the dogs, so you don't want neighbors like we were. Okay.
The nisba?
The nisba.
What does that mean?
Okay, nisba means what? It means ascription.
Yes.
Okay, ascription. A nisba adjective is like you say, for example, Iraq. For example, the person with a nisba adjective, students, Arabists. What is a nisba adjective? It is Iraqi. Okay, it has a ya on the end of it, and you form an adjective with it. Okay. And the nisba, when you scribe, it means here a nisba is, we're talking, what sort of a nisba are we talking about? We're talking about an idafa. Nisba to idafiya. Okay, and what is a idafa construction in Arabic? It's the X of the Y. The X of the Y. Okay, and how do you make that? You say, sayadat tariq, for example. Tariq's car. Car of tariq. And so the people of Nisba are the people who have an ascriptive tie to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, by taking a spiritual path that is connected to, through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, person from person from person from person, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to Jibreel. Okay, the Ruh al-Akbar, Jibreel, to Rabb al-Azza, to the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are Ahlullah, Ahlullah. Okay, ahl means what? Means the people. Okay, or specifically the close people. If you say the Arabs, for example, out of shyness, you know, they typically say mak ahlak. Or if even if it's more adib, they say mak nas. Okay, they say instead of saying, well, my wife's here, they say my ahl is here, my family. Okay, this is usually the way that they'll express it. Okay, and before Islam, ahlullah meant who? It meant the Quraysh. Because they worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They worshipped, you know, 360 other idols also, but they were called, among the Arabs of the Jazeera of the peninsula, they were called Ahlullah because they had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as their specific, the one that they worshipped, and specifically other than the other tribes did not. So they were called Ahlullah. And after Islam came and Atal Haq was Zahiq al-Batil, and the bottle slithered away, and the Prophet went around the Kaaba, turning over, overturning each of the idols in turn, you know, one after another. People who believe in that all religions are valid, including Islam, should take a look at this, should think about this incredible madhar of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and them turning over the idols. If all had been sahih or valid, he wouldn't have had the bother of doing it. And after this, the people, Ahlullah, were the people, especially of this nisbah, of the nisbah of tasawwuf. So when you see Ahlullah used as in the nomenclature, this is anybody who has taken the tariq. Okay, is Ahl al-Nisbah. So anybody who takes the tariq is called Muntasib. Muntasib. Or Muntasiba, if they're a woman. And this is a very high rank with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a high standard and it's a high rank because the tariq means a spiritual path. Someone who, subhanallah, ma ja'ala dalala ala awliya'ihi, illa min haythu dalalatu alayhi. It's Ibn Atta'ila, the second khalifa of Abu Hassan Shah, that he said, he says, glory be to him who didn't make the indication, who didn't lead anybody to his awliya except those who he wanted to lead to himself. Okay, and this is a lineal and spiritual connection with the awliya, all of the great shaykhs of the tariq, Abu Basim Mursi, Abu Hasan Shatiri. It's a sunnah in Islam to make as many friends among the mu'mineen as possible. Why? Because if you die and you go to the hellfire, that they'll be able to make intercession for you. They'll say, where on earth is Nuh? We used to see him among us when we are on earth. They say, well, he's in the hellfire. And they'll say, well, Allah, please bring him out. And Allah will hear the intercession of the people. So it's a sunnah to make as many friends as possible. Okay, so that they can make intercession. So how should it be with the awliya? Yeah. How should it be with the awliya? Glory be to him who did not make the indication or did not make the guidance to be able to reach the awliya, except in as much that he made it a guidance to unto himself. So Allah doesn't lead anybody to the path except that he wants them to complete it and reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in other words. So this is part of our yaqeen about the path. I know. It's one of the things that Ibn al-Arabi, we mentioned to some of the brothers, that Ibn al-Arabi, he had a wife in Andalusia who was interested in the spiritual path. And she wondered, she fell asleep one night and she had a dream and she saw a mystery figure in her dream, perhaps Khidr or perhaps another. And she said, well, what is it that that a person needs to undertake the spiritual path? And he said, well, he said, you need four things. He says, you need tawakkul, and you need yaqeen, and you need sabr, and you need sidq. He said, and all of these are key things, but the one I wanted to mention is yaqeen. And in this, okay, tawakkul, relying totally on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we mentioned, this tariq is only a sabab, it's only a proximate cause. It's not something we can rely on to necessarily do anything, because nothing necessarily does anything except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Necessarily is by the fact of who he is. Okay, tawakkul. Yaqeen. Okay, yaqeen is total certainty. And this is what somebody who needs, and there are other names for it in the tariq. You could call it taslim if you wanted. Okay, it's taslim, surrender, i.e. to one's shaykh in terms of belief in the directions, the directives that he gives one. Okay, this is a manifestation of yaqeen. Okay, absolute certainty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not have guided you down to the tariq except that he wants to guide you to himself. Okay. This is another, the second thing that the mystery figure told his wife of Ibn al-Arabi. Third is sabr, okay, patience. Okay, meaning day after day, keeping up the adab, keeping up the, drawing nearer and nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by that which Allah has made obligatory for every human being. And then after that, the nawafil. مَا تَقَرَّبَ لَيَا عَبْدِ بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ مَفْتَرَدُّهُ عَلَيْهِ. My servant approaches me with nothing more beloved to me than that which I have made obligatory for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Talking in this hadith al-Qudsi related by Bukhari. وَمَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِ يَتَقَرَّبُ لَيَا بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ. And my slave keeps drawing nearer and nearer to me with supererogatory works of worship until I love him. And that's what our tariq is about, is love, ultimately. يُحِبُّهُمْ or يُحِبُّونَهُ. Okay. He loves them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they love him. If Allah hadn't loved them, they wouldn't have loved him, in reality. In reality, if you want to look at it from the hadra of the ahadiyya, of the absolute oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only sincere love is love of oneself. Say otherwise, every other kind of love is contingent. Okay, is love for oneself, we could say. And so in reality, the only pure, the only true, the only absolute love is Allah's love for himself. And our love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is from that. In reality, it's a manifestation of Allah's love for himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every love is a reflection of the divine love, ultimately. Allah. From this point of view, Ibn al-Arabi says also, he says, well, we're just created people. And he says, we're incapable of loving Allah for his sake. He says, we love Allah for our own sake. So everyone people talk about the nafs and tasawwuf, and the nafs, meaning the lower human self, the nafs is this way and the nafs is that way. And if not for the nafs, we couldn't reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَوْلَا مَا يَدِينَ النَّفُوسَ لَمَا تَحَقَّقَ سَيْرُ السَّائِرِينَ. If not for the arenas of the lower selves, the progressus, the change, the path from one thing to the next thing, to the next thing, to the next thing, to the next thing, to the ultimate victory of winning unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not be realized. So you shouldn't imagine that things are all this bad because of yourself. Yourself is something very precious. When it is purified, when it is attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it becomes transmuted from lead into gold by its love of the divine, it has become something very, very precious. There's a tremendous secret in it.
لو
لما يدين النفوس لما تحقق سير سائرين.
What was the second word?
ميادين.
ميادين.
No. جمع.
ميدان.
Maidan is the field, is a battlefield. There's a plain in front of the walled city of Damascus on which the armies used to fight. It was called the Maidan, the arena of which the, on which the armies, the battlefield, in other words, in which they fight. And now it's incorporates part of the city now. The Maidan is where the Ordon Mount is. So they used to sally forth from the city walls and fight the armies. And then, now the Maidan and the Nafus, if not for the battlegrounds of the selves. And the self does not mean the you. We talked about you last night. What is the reality of you? The reality of the you is your, is the infinite you, is the station that you reach for infinity forever. Okay. You were created for foreverness, for eternity. Okay. So the eternal you is the real you. The real you is not you as you were 20 years ago or 40 years ago, whatever it is, when you were crawling around on the rug and annoying your parents. And the real you is not as you as you are at age 23 when you're young and strong and vital, or age 33 or 53 or whatever age. Or nor is the real you you as you are hobbling out of the masjid on your, with your cane and your two legs, you know, barely able to carry you to and from the salat as you will be, you know, after a very short, after shorter than you think. None of these is the real you. The real you is your, is you in your body and your mind and your ruh, as you will be in paradise. This is the real you. And so tasawwuf consider is you know, it takes people as they are. Okay? Not people as they are now, but the people as they really are. And as we mentioned, eternity is already present at Allah, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at this moment. Allah is not waiting for anything to happen. That's why Allah is very patient. That's why He's sabur. It's because He sees the big picture, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sees the long term, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sees things as they really are. That's why He's putting up with us. That's why He doesn't make the earth swallow us. Somebody came up to Shaykh al-Hashimi, and they said, well, Sidi, we want to see a miracle. You know, we're tired of all this talk, you know. You know, why can't we fly? Why can't you fly through the air, walk on water, do something really astounding? You know, at the edib of the commonality of the ordinary people, I eat no edib. And so Shaykh al-Hashmi got up and he danced around the circle of the murids and he sat down again. And he says, the man said, well, he says, that's not a miracle. And he says, well, the miracle is that Allah didn't cause the earth to swallow me for doing such a levitous active behavior. You know, and this is really the core karama of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that as bad as we are, and that with our continual affronts to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He doesn't just make the whole page fold up on us, you know, and the earth swallow us. But this is with a wisdom. This is with a wisdom that our nafs, as bad as it is, we can do something, and we have the thawab, we have the reward for improving it. In other words, we have an intention to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How strange. You know, some people will say, well, if Allah is infinitely merciful, how could He send people into the hellfire forever? How could He send people to hell forever? What a strange thing. And some person has had the audacity and the bad edib and the kufr, actually, we should say with the name that is proper to it, to say the only person that would deserve an infinite hell would be God Himself. And Frijof Schwon said this in Understanding Islam. But this is not the case. And people deserve an infinite punishment because people are not rewarded for finite acts. People are not rewarded for their finite acts with an infinite. They are rewarded for their intention. And the person's intention is infinite. Okay, what does this mean? That you intend to become one of the Arifin. Okay, the Arifin, someone who knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is not impossible. Many people have reached it. Not the knowledge, the experiential knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a special kind of the awliya. This is a special group. an elite of the awliya. Not all of the awliya are arifin, are Gnostics, and those who know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not all of them have this degree. Okay, so you aspire to this degree. You want to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to reach Jannah in this life. Jannah al-Ma'arif. Okay. To, out of obedience to the divine command, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. Know that there is no God but Allah. Okay, and your intention is that if Allah were to keep you alive for 80,000 years, if He were to keep you alive for 40 more years, which is quite a tall order of business for someone like me, don't expect that that'll happen. If you, that inshallah, my intention is to continue to worship Allah during those 40 years. Like Junaid was asked, you know, he said, you know, he was asked something on his deathbed, and he didn't reply. And he was asked again, and then he replied, and he says, well, why didn't you talk to me the first time? He says, I was saying my wird. So he never, even in that dire extremity, you know, he was, in other words, when you take a wird, when you take a spiritual path, what your intention is to do it. When you take any new act of worship that you're going to do, and this is a principle in the tariq, if you do anything for 40 days, it becomes like a wajib. You should continue on it, okay, as much as you possibly can until the day you die. And this is everything in the tariq. And this is what we intend. And so because of this, and our rewards, our actions, we're not rewarded for our actions. Rewarded for, because Allah has created them. How should we deserve a reward for something someone else has created? Okay. We're rewarded for our intentions behind these actions. The intention is what the slave has. Intention is what we have. And our intention is to be mu'mineen forever. We intend to be mu'mineen until the buried. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had kept us alive for not just 40 more years or 30 more years, but 100 more years, we would continually be going to the masjid. We would continually be going to saying our wird. We would be continually trying to rise in spiritual station and get closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We would be continually having, not being unaware of Allah in any of the madahir, any of the manifestations of Him. Okay, so we would continue, we'd be doing our acts of worship. If He would keep us alive for 1,500 years, we would be doing the same. SubhanAllah. The Shajara Mubarakah. There are trees in Jordan that the blessed tree of the olive tree. The bread that you had last night, Muhammad, was made from olives that, from a tree that is, 1,400 years old. It's been giving fruit to human beings to eat, olives, every year since the Romans planted it. And since the time of the Prophet, or before the time of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why the Quran describes it as a Shajara Mubarakah. It continues giving benefit year after year after year after year after year after year. In addition to the high food value of the olives, of the olive oil. So the movement is like that. If Allah kept him alive forever, he would intend to keep worshipping, you know, forever in this world. As for the next world, there won't be any wudu or salat there. Okay? There will be the rewards, the fruits of that wudu and salat will be there. So the mu'mineen have an infinite, have endless bliss. And someone who wants to think about two English words, let them think about these two English words, endless bliss. What does it mean? Something very tremendous. It has a very tremendous meaning. Okay. It's not our goal, of course. Our goal is the goal of Rabi'a al-Adawiyya, this great mystic, this great Sufi lady, who said, Ajar thumma dar, the neighbor first, and then the house. Who's the neighbor? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why she wants Jannah. Okay. And similarly, the kafir, if you would keep him alive for 1,500 years, if you would keep him alive for 50,000 years, he has no intention to change. He has the Big Bang Theory. He has, what can you say? He has a whole array of opinions and of theories that he's proud of them. You know? And if you gave him 50,000 more years, he doesn't intend to change any of them. He was going to Halab, to Aleppo, on the plane. It's hard for him to drive to places these days, to give some lessons. And the day that he was supposed to go on to Aleppo to teach, he came down with a tremendous cold, you know, sneezing and wheezing tremendous head cold. And so he canceled. He says, no, I won't go. Why? because he didn't want the murids to see him in such a condition. Okay, he considers himself, and he is, an ambassador, you know, to teach a certain sort of knowledge. And so he didn't want to, you know, give the murids waswasa, the murids to be screened or to be veiled by the humanity of the sheikh from his spirituality. Okay, so this isn't, but despite which, I don't have that edit. Here I came despite the cold. Okay, so this is the wisdom in the adab. You know, in Damascus, for example, we're reading the Al-Adab al-Mardiyya, an unpublished manuscript that exists only in manuscript, as many of the books of the Sufis do, because they're meant to be taught to a circle of disciples. And as we will be teaching, inshallah, in the next few days with certain manuscripts and books, inshallah. They're not meant to be, you know, quote, bestsellers or something, you know, and to fill the pockets of the booksellers with money. But rather they were meant to be taught in mudhakara sessions of the sheikh teaching a small circle of disciples. This is termed mudhakara. And this book is called Al-Adab al-Mardiyya. And it is the proper way of adab, as we mentioned, manners, etiquette, etc. But in a way, we in Islamic books, we also have, for example, adab al-qital. And it would be somewhat of a strain to translate it, the proper etiquette for killing people. But rather, it's the proper way of going about, you know, fighting in jihad or something like this. Okay, so the main reason for adab towards the sheikh, the adab of the students toward the sheikh in the tariq, is what? Is so that the humanity is not a veil, the humanity of the sheikh is not a veil from the spirituality. So that it can be like Rumi said, he said, don't look at me, but take what is in my hand. Okay? So the adab of the tariq are a means so that the murids don't focus on the person of the sheikh. And as we mentioned before, the Shadali Tariqa does not emphasize the person of the sheikh. Okay? But as for the function of the sheikh, the adab of the Shadaliya towards the function of the sheikh is equal or superior to the other tariqas. You know, if the sheikh has a, you know, kind of a uniform that all of the murids wear, you know, if the sheikh has his turban this way, all of the murids better get their turban going that way too. So this is not, you know, we don't emphasize, and they have the rabita, for example, Muhammad Rashid Hazrat Levin, who died, one of the great ulama of the Naqshbandi tariqa. He had nearly 3 million murids in Turkey by the time he died. They had rabita, focusing on the person of the sheikh, each night at Maghrib, and a sort of a spiritual tie, inner tie with the sheikh, and where they imagine the person of the sheikh while they're making dhikr, actually. And we don't have this in the Shatadi tariqa. We don't focus on the person of the sheikh. As Shaykh Abdurrahman says, "Ana fi jismi haba, wa fi ruhi sama." He says in a qasida, in one of his poems. He says, "Our Shaykh is a poet." And he says, "I am in my person, in my body." He says, "I am just, I don't know what the word for it is.
Nothing.
Dust." Yeah. It's, you know, when you see a ray of in an old closet room, for example, in which there is a window, you know, an attic room in which there is a window, you go up there and, you know, you open up the chest of all the old photographs, you know, of mom and dad, and suddenly the dust flies around and you see the sunlight that's coming through the window, and you see the dust in the air that draws that ray of sunlight that's coming in. What's that, the dust, does it have a name in English? In Arabic you'd call that haba. In other words, dust that's blowing through the air, that's filtering through the air, that's haba. In other words, something of no importance to whatsoever. And wa ana fi ruhi sama, and I in my ruh, in my spirit, I am a sky, I'm a celestial. In other words, as the sheikh describing himself. Allah. Abul Hasan Shadhili is a footnote to the way that we look at other people. He said, if you have to, he says that the people, or that the Sufis, they don't see people. You know, they don't see other people as individual people. So-and-so benefited me, but so-and-so stepped on my toes and humiliated me in front of the other people, so I hate him forever after. No, we don't see people as this person and that person, this person and that person. But we see them He says, when can or what I would, if needs be, he says, you should see them as a dust within a ray of light, like that ray of light coming through the attic window. He says, this ray of light is Allah's creating of them. They're continually winking into existence and winking out of existence, but the ray stays the same, and it's the divine fiat, kun fayakun, be, and it is. So all people and all things, all phenomenal reality, is outwardly creation, but inwardly it's divine, the divine command, kun, be. And so you have to have adab with other people and other things. The adab, among the adab of Salat al-Jumu'ah is to go a little bit early.
Yes.
And so perhaps it's time to, is it time to take off yet?
Yeah, it's 12 now.
Why don't we take off just for practice?
Yeah,
we should. Imam al-Ghazali said this was the first bid'ah that came into Islam. And the people started becoming late for Jumu'ah. So we should try to get over there. Inshallah. Alhamdulillah.
For brothers who want to see the Sheikh, inshallah, in the next 2 or 3 days in a more private way, because some brothers told me that concern.
If people have special questions, if it's a question about tasawwuf, please. All of the people who came are the elite, as far as I'm concerned. And every single issue about tasawwuf, even if it's, even for those of you who have entered the khalwa, even if you're wadidat or whatever, please put them out and we'll answer them in public. If you don't want to tell who you are, just give them to me on a piece of paper and I'll answer them. Anything about the tariq, we want to answer publicly so that people can have the benefit of it. No matter whether it's high level or whether it's ordinary level or what level it is, please bring your questions and we'll answer them publicly if it's about tasawwuf. If it's about your own personal, if it's about your own personal path, whether you should do this or do that or something like that, then if it's private like that, then if it doesn't have any benefit for the others, then see Sidi Tariq and register your name, and then we'll make time for you, in particular for private, you know, consultations and so forth. Inshallah, tawfiq for tafsir. What are we going to do, inshallah, in the next week? We're going to read some texts and all of this. You know, you're going to hear some of the things repeated because I can't change the fabric of reality. We're talking about reality here. Okay, and so we're talking about what concerns us the most and getting serious about our ultimate spiritual stations. You know, this is what we're talking about. And so we might draw attention to some things more than once. But I have brought some materials to teach, and one of these is the Qasidas, the Arabic poetry. The tariq is hard, as we mentioned yesterday. The tariq is hard. It's not easy, but it's not difficult either. It's not difficult, but it's not easy. It's something between the two, just like the khalwa. Khalwa is not easy, but it's not difficult. Many people have done it. Okay, so it's not impossible. Similarly, tasawwuf is hard. One of the hard things, one of the things is that there has to be submission. There has to be, for better or for worse, there's a lot of people that are running boats in the harbor. And, you know, you can go over and see who they are and get on their boat. But anybody who gets on this boat, who takes me as the murshid, has to understand that they have to listen. Okay, this is a point. Somebody was asked, it wouldn't hurt to record this if we stopped, okay. Somebody went to a Turkish sheikh, and he said, you know, many people, they tend to show the sheikh their information that they have about Sufism at first, you know, to impress the sheikh with that they're really in the know. And, you know, it's just, I know I did it myself. I'll get through about it. Allah forgive me. Teaching the sheikh. And they said, well, I've read the entire, they went to a Turkish sheikh, and they said, well, I've read the entire Mathnawi of Jalaluddin Rumi in German. And the person was a German who went to the sheikh. And the sheikh said, oh, really? He said, did you understand? And he says, inshallah. And he says, what is the first word of it? And he was stuck. You know, you get stuck sometimes. You can't remember what you're trying to do. You're searching that memory, you know. You can't, especially if you got a middle-aged memory like mine. So he's, you know, searching. And the sheikh gets up and walks out. The man's just sitting there, you know, he's trying to, what's the first word of it? What's the first word of it? And the sheikh goes down the steps, you know, and he gets into the car. He's waiting to go to the airport. You know, he's going to leave town. And finally, he says, well, you know, he says, you said you understood it. You know, what's the first word of it? And so he's trying to think. And then finally comes to them. So he runs out the door and he runs down the stairs and he catches the sheikh before it. He says, it's listen. So that's the first word of the Masnavi. Listen. Okay. And so that's the first of the adab, you know, when to imagine, well, you know, here's just this, you know, this person who's sitting in front of us, you know, he's the sheikh, you know, he says so in his portfolio. That's not it. You know, when Allah brings something to the sheikh's lips and causes you to hear it, there's a wisdom and there's a reason in that it came out then. So it's not part of the adab of the majalis that you say, well, the sheikh was talking to so-and-so who's sitting beside me. That's his problem. You know, that's not, rather the person who hears, it's part of hearing, the part of the adab of the majalis that a person applies to what is said to himself. Or herself. Okay, this is part of the adab. You don't make a detour, you know, transfer, you know, to the person who's sitting next to you and saying, "Well, the sheikh intended to push something into that person over there." You know, so that's not part of the adab. So we have to listen. Inshallah, during these next couple of days, we'll be teaching various aspects of the tariq. Some of them are the poems. And one of the things that I've asked everybody to do who takes this tariq is to learn Arabic. And this is one of the difficult things. You know, this is I used to think I was smart until I tried to learn Arabic. It's a very humbling experience. Okay. Learning Arabic is a humbling experience. And there's various wisdom. One is that it's the lugha of Ahl Jannah. The people of Jannah will speak Arabic, as the Prophet has informed us. The second thing is the closeness to the Nusus in Pakistan, or if I was an Indian sheikh or a Pakistani sheikh, or a Western sheikh, you know, the chances are that most of the murids wouldn't know anything about Arabic, and so they would rely and depend on the sheikh to interpret everything to them. And this is good if the sheikh is okay, is straight, you know, is mustaqim, is on the sirat al-mustaqim. It's okay, it works. But if the sheikh turns bad or goes bad, or something happens to the sheikh, then their religion goes that way also. Okay, so we want to teach people, I'm not interested in having an army of followers around me forever, or until the day I die. I'm interested in turning out people who are arifin, who are awliya, who can walk on their own two feet, who are accomplished spirituals, who know the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inwardly and outwardly, and who follow it. Okay, and this entails that you become ulama, that you become knowledgeable in the deen. And secondly, that I want you to become not only ordinary Sufis with a pure heart, anybody who knows the Fatiha can do this. You know, they can say their prayers and become pure-hearted Sufis who are high in stature with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I want you to become cultivated Sufis. Sufis who can open a book of tasawwuf, open the futuhat, open the books of the greatest sheikhs of the tariqah, and understand what is going on. Understand from whence these people spoke these words. Okay, because the books of tasawwuf, not the translations, but the books of tasawwuf, so often you find that that great sheikh summarized 30 years of spiritual struggle in two lines, and that he can give it to you if you're ready to stand before that door, if you have the key in your hand. Okay, by your hal, what you are, what you have become, by following the spiritual path, and by understanding the language that he's speaking in. Okay, and for all of these reasons, we don't want a person to be unnecessarily dependent on the sheikh in their Islam when they finish the tariqah. They want them to be dependent on the nusus. Okay, they want to be able to understand the texts of Islam and follow them. For all of these reasons, and also for the reasons of the higher spiritual, the upper register, spiritual progress, when you're finished Sufis, inshallah, we want to connect you with the tradition. For all of these reasons, we want you to understand Arabic. Okay, so we want everybody who takes the tariq should make a program for themselves and spend that 20 minutes a week working on your Arabic. So to encourage this, where the qasidas, the poetry, the Arabic poetry, we're going to sing it. Also because people are so uptight and we want to release their nafus, you know, in this country, nobody sings anymore. You know, they don't, they everything is canned. You know, turn on that sound system and listen to so-and-so sing it, you know. So we're not interested in that. We're interested in live action. Okay, you. Okay, live. Now. Okay, so when the ikhwan meet, we want to have some qasidas sung. Okay, you know, the canned is okay for people who can't buy fresh, can't eat fresh. But the ones who can eat and buy fresh, you know, you're the action. This is the reason also why Islam doesn't have, we don't have pictures in Islam. Don't have the picture of the sheikh sitting on the wall. After 17 years, I still don't have a picture of the sheikh. Okay. We'll talk about this more, inshallah.
Yeah.
Did you get a chance to read the tariqah notes?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. I'd like people to read the tariqah notes so they can see what's going on. Have you seen the new copy of that? The tariqah notes?
I have the one that got 95, 96
Yeah, I think that's fairly, yeah, it's fairly current. Yeah, that's the most recent one. CD Omar printed it up for us, 1,000 copies. Yeah. No, I don't know what happened to that. It was probably sent surface or something.
I think they told me something about what happened to it. I'll find out today. I can't remember.
Yeah, okay. It eventually came. It was somebody wrote the wrong name. My name on it wrong, and the address is also wrong.
So but
the 20 came in mail, right. In the mail. And so maybe the addressing should be. There should be some concern for it. Bismillah. Sunnah of the tariq, that the people who have already taken the tariq, when the sheikh gives the tariq to put their hands on it. Okay. Or if you can't reach it, to put your hand on the shoulder of the person who can reach it. Bismillah. Al-Fatiha. Bismillah. وأن تذكر الله صباحا ومساء أن تبتلي بالاستعادة مرة واحدة بالبسملة ثلاث مرات ثم تقول وما تقدم لأنفسكم من خير تجده عند الله هو خيرا وأعظم أجرا واستغفر الله إن الله غفور رحيم استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله مائة مرة في تمام ومائة استغفر الله العظيم الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسولك النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسولك النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسولك النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسولك النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم مائة مرة في تمام مائة وسلم تسليما بقدر عظمة ذاتك في كل وقت وحين فاعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله مائة مرة وإن كانت لديك فرصة من وقت فلا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير مائة مرة في تمام مائة لا إله إلا الله سيدنا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم تقرأ سورة الإخلاص بالبسملة ثلاث مرات وتختمها بالفاتحة مرة واحدة ثم تدعو لنفسك ولأبويك ولأشياخك وللفقراء الصوفية ولجميع المسلمين وعلينا جميعا بالمحافظة على الصلوات وببر الوالدين وبالنصح لكل مسلم نحن أصبحنا إخوانا في الله إن يجب أن يأخذ بيد أخيه فأحدكم على هذا البر بقدر استطاعتكم وكذلك على حساب أبي الحسن الشاذلي رضي الله عنه وقراءة شيء من القرآن في النهار ولا قليلا وبالله تعالى توفيق والحمد لله رب العالمين فاتح
waiting for the ladies to come, we can sing the qasida of the Shaykh. Yeah. Inshallah, next time we come, we'll bring Shaykh Ismail with us so he can help with the qasidas. It's really quite a good munshid. رفعت أستار البين وبدت أنوار العين تنجلي من غير عين فشهدوها يا صوفية أنا مرآة حبيبي في هواه روح طيبي عن سواه نفسي بيبي واطرح الأشياء الرندية وزبدا في ذي المشاهد صرت راقيا وشاجد شاكرا له وحامد الطواني في الهوية يا هنائي في لقائي يا بقائي في فنائي يا ضيائي في سمائي يا حياتي الأبدية أقبل الساقي علينا قدم الكاس إلينا فاحتسينا وارتوينا من كؤوس الهاشمية صاحي فاغنم المعاش كم بيت آتاهم هاشا هاشا أن يخيب هاشا من أتى بصدق النية أخلف البخل التجلي واجل عينك للتملي وسواي خل خلي وافنى في الذات العهلية واشرب الكأس جهارا لا ترى في الشرب عارا وهم واخلع العطار في المعاني الأقداسية جزي سيرا للمناسب وانتهج نهج الأوائل لا تمل لقولي عادم إنما الإصغى بلية هي كل الكل أصلا ليس للعذال فعلا ما عدو للحب إلا مرسل من ذي العطية ثم صندي ذا الجمال على باب الاتصال فهم الصحب وآل ما حدا حد المعطية. So I was asked about Sama' on the way to the to Salat al-Jumu'ah, and in particular about the Hadra in relation to the words of some of the Fuqaha of the Malikis, that of the Tahrim al-Sama'. Tahrim al-Sama' is literally the prohibition of Sama' means audition, literally. And what does it mean? Listening to something, okay? And it can mean listening to anything, like listening to the qasida, that we just singing the qasida out and listening to it that we just did. Some of the ulama of this ummah have declared this to be haram, some of the Hanafis. Okay. And I wanted to address that a little bit about in relation to the hadra. And they said, well, if some of them are for it and some of them are against it, as we know from the Imam al-Nawawi's Minhaj al-Talibin in the Shafi'i school, it's mubah. And if it moves one to praiseworthy states, then it's a work of ibadah. It's a mustahab. Okay, and so they said, Murtad, this question, what he's wondering about was, some of them are against it and some of them are for it. Then isn't the way of the Sufis to leave the things that are differed upon and adopt the more, the safer path? You know, so how come we're listening to, you know, Sama'a, and in particular, how come we're doing the Hadra, you know, for example? And the answer is from the various means. And also the person that was talking about the Hadra, he quoted Ahmad Zarruq,
who is one of the sheikhs of the tariqah, and he's one of the lions, one of the sheikhs of the tariqah, and he has several books about tasawwuf, and he was a great murshid. He was from Fas, I believe, originally, and he died in Libya with Edis Alia. If you ever go to Libya, you can visit him, inshallah. And the answer is that, or that I gave when we were talking, is that, you know, first of all, and Ahmad Zarruq also believed that it was reprehensible, that it was wrong to say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim at the beginning of the Fatiha in every salat. Okay, now, as people in the same tariqah as Ahmad Zarruq, are we obliged to follow his ijtihad in that question also? Or his madhab, so to speak, his position, the position that he adopted in that? The answer is no. Okay, rather, having written a little bit about it and studied a bit about it, I'm absolutely convinced that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and he did so aloud when he prayed in his salat, in his public salat. Okay, so I'm absolutely convinced of that. And so, I say, well, no, Ahmad Zarruq was mistaken. And there was an ijtihad that was not sawab. And this is not an attack on Ahmad Zarruq. Okay, this is a fiqhi question. This is a fiqhi question. And I can cite others of the tariqah who agreed with him. In other words, practically all of them were Malikis. And so they're all with Malik's ijtihad, and Malik had a reward for this ijtihad that the basmala was makruh and the fard salat. Okay, but we don't agree with it. It is the case of all ijtihad. Namely, we say with Imam Shafi, you say that my ijtihad is sawab wa yahtamal al khata wa ijtihadu khasmi khata wa yahtamal al sawab. My ijtihad is correct, but the ijtihad of my opponent, but it's possible that it could be a mistake. Whereas the ijtihad of my opponent on this question is a mistake, although it's possible it could be correct. And that's what every mujtahid believes about his ijtihad. You know, it's this position. And so this is a normal fiqhi difference. Okay, so this is a normal fiqhi difference. If you want to find someone else who disagreed about it, of the great sheikhs of the tariq, Muhyiddin ibn Arabi, he didn't say that this amount was not permissible as far as he was concerned. Right? Ruh al-Qudus fi muhasabat al-nafs, for example, seems to indicate that. We're reading that in Amman now with the Arabic, with the Arab students that have taken a tariq. Okay, and so what do we say? We say that Ahlan wa Sahlan, you know, all of the fiqh ijtihads of the sheikhs of the tariq, we say ala rasi. We say, you know, we have deference to them, you know, because they're mujtahideen. Abu Hasan al-Shadhili was another one who didn't like sama in his time. Okay, but what do we say about our ijtihad? Well, what makes us so sure that the sama is permissible then? That listening to qasidas is permissible? And we say simply the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith sahih sang at the Ghazwat al-Khandaq as he was digging the trench. He sang. Okay, and this is a sahih hadith. And this is why in the Ahmad Zarruq's Nasihat al-Kafiyah, while it is a great book, it's not a, you know, it's not a top metan of the Maliki Madhab. And if we look at the top metan of the Maliki Madhab, for example, there are two principal, two of the greatest works for fatwa are the Hashat al-Dasuqi, and for the Western Malikis, you know, from Mauritania over to Libya, approximately. And for the Eastern Malikis, from Egypt over to the Gulf countries, which are also Maliki. The Sharh al-Sadir by Ahmad al-Darir on Aqrab al-Masadiq upon his own Sharh, upon his own Metan. And this is the Hashia of Sawi upon it. You know, this is below Sawi, the Aqidah, the Imam. Sawi and Maliki Faqih. And he says, he quotes Suhrawardi on the question of Sama, in the book itself, in the Sharh al-Sadir, this great Maliki resource of fatwa, he says anybody who says that Sama is haram is either jaf al-taba or jahilun bil-athar. He's either got a dried up heart, you know, no sensitivity, or else he's ignorant of the hadith. And these are, you know, it's very strong words, but we honor the ijtihad of those, but we don't adopt it. Okay. So also, we look to see the, you know, not just Ahmad Zarruq finding something on our own. It shouldn't come up. Why? Because your sheikh makes sama and goes to the hadra. Okay. Myself, I haven't missed a hadra for a long time now. You know, when it's been in my ability to go to one. My sheikh and your grand sheikh, Sheikh Abdurrahman al-Shaghuri, he's a munshid with a whole diwan of poetry that he spent his whole life as the leader of the singers of the Qasaid at the Hadra, you know, 60 years. So somebody who says, well, no, it must be haram or it must be makruh or something like this, they have this waswasa. Okay, something that the sheikh has made an integral part of the tariqah is something that is not subject to the ijtihads of the murids, you know. So, you know, I realize that we come here in America. America is basically a Wahhabi atmosphere, and everything that's any different from Wahhabism has to bring a delil to show why it's different from Wahhabism, you know. But that's not the position of our sheikh, certainly. Okay, well, what's in it? What's the benefit of the hadra? That's more interesting. As for the proof of the hadra, we've talked about some of the delils in the tariqah notes. And the opinion of Suyuti, Jalaluddin Suyuti, is recognized as a mujtahid by everybody, as is Imam Nawawi. Okay, and these are the fiqh texts that show that it's halal and valid in at least one method. But the more important thing, after we've established that it's halal, by at least one of the ijtihads of the mujtahideen, is that, first of all, it's not merely halal, and it's not merely somebody said it's mubah, and so we can do it following his ijtihad. Rather, it's an act of worship, and those who say that it's something other than an act of worship are mistaken. Okay, that's my position. That to go to the hadra, you'll have more than if you stay home, and don't go to the hadra. Okay, the same as if when you get together in a group of people. And you all shout out at the top of your lungs, you know, for example, you're on a desert island or an atoll or something, and there's steamers coming by and you're stranded there. If you all raise your voice together and shout at the top of your lungs, and there are 5 or 10 of you there, if you all shout together, your voice has a chance to be heard. Why? Because it strengthens. The voices strengthen each other, and it'll carry farther. Okay? The same happens at the spiritual level with dhikr. When many people are making dhikr together, the dhikr is stronger. And there are spiritual effects in that dhikr that you will not find making the dhikr by yourself. Okay, nobody denies that except when somebody with a dead heart. Okay, we're not talking to them. You guys all have live hearts. Okay, you should realize this. Okay, and also there's another thing that we were talking about a little bit last night, is that, you know, people with emotional problems, can they benefit from the tariq, or if they have, for example, they have a roller coaster sort of nafs that, you know, they have high, you know, elative times, and they have depressive times. And one of the many advantages of connecting with the ulama of the heart, and connecting with the medicines, the traditional prophetic medicines that treat the human condition and treat the hearts, is that it attenuates the ups and downs of the heart. You know, this bust and qabd, as they call it. Bust meaning expansiveness and happiness and so forth. Qabd meaning, you know, contracted and depressed, okay, and so it evens out. It gets it onto an even keel. Okay, one of the most important elements of doing this, and this is why that the people who come, for example, the people who have come and have stayed with us, you know, for a period of months in Jordan, and the people who come to Syria and stayed. They progress, their spiritual progress is good. You know, it goes forward because they're going to the hadra every week. And because this harmony in itself attenuates these emotional, the ups and downs. The harmony is, if you want, you know, to use a vulgar modern term, therapy. Okay, at an emotional level. Okay, there's something in the soul that responds to music. Okay. And for all of these reasons, because the dhikr is stronger. Another reason to go to the hadra is because many of the awliya come to them. And we're talking, you know, as we mentioned yesterday, the nature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He doesn't make the spiritual states, and he doesn't make the illuminations, and he doesn't make the futuhat, the intuitions and the spiritual stations that are achieved in the spiritual path. He doesn't, what is the Ibn Ta'ala's, la yati al-waridu illa bagta, siyanatan laha. Al-wirada al-waridat al-ilahiyya la ta'ti illa bagtatan. سِيَانَةَ النَّهَا مِنْ أَنْ يَدَّعِيهَا الْعَبْدِ بِوَجُودِ الْإِسْتَعْدَادِ. Okay, the spiritual states and stations and intuitions, the fruits of one's spiritual striving, do not come except suddenly. They come suddenly, all of a sudden, when you least expect them. You know, unexpectedly, surprisingly. Okay, when you least expect them. Why? As Ibn Ta'ala says in his Hikmah, he says, why? Because in order to protect them from the slave claiming them as his, I did it.
Achievement.
Yeah, it's my achievement. With my readiness, I was ready for it, therefore it had happened to me. No. They're assigned only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes. And so they only come suddenly. Okay, and sometimes they come in unexpected times. Okay, you have to be ready for them by the adab, by worshipping Allah day and night, inwardly and outwardly, always. You know, from minute to minute, hour to hour, day to day, and week to week. But that's not enough. That's not the reason that they come. It's from Allah's grace, and Allah's largesse, and Allah's generosity.
Can you repeat it, please, in Arabic? Al-Waridat?
I'm not sure. The text, I'm a little bit shaky on. Okay. I haven't memorized it as it should be memorized. But the meaning is, La ta'ti al-Waridat al-Ilahiyya illa baghta. سِيَانَةَ لَهَا مِنْ أَنْ يَدَّعِيهَا الْعَبْدِ بِوَجُودِ الْإِسْتِعْدَادِ. And then there's another thing, as a protection for them, from the slave claiming them by his spiritual aptitude, his spiritual readiness. Okay, and so when you go to the Hadra, there is a strong, you know, one of the asbab that Allah has made for his grace and for the heart to become illumined, is when one of the awliya looks at you in a certain way, you know, or makes a dua for you, or something like that. You know, the awliya looks at someone, the awliya looks at someone and he says, oh, Allah, help this person. And the person is never the same after this dua ever. Okay, and this happens when at the hadra, it happens, you know. One of the brothers in the tariq went to one of the hadras in the morning at the Majlis Salat Nabi on Wednesday mornings in Damascus. And the eye of one of the awliya fell upon him. And he achieved at that moment what he didn't achieve in 6 years of spiritual efforts. Okay, so it's the nature of that we have to have, Ela inna li rabbikum min ayami dahrikum nafahat. That verily, as the hadith the Prophet says, verily, your Lord has of the days of your life, winds that blow. Spiritual winds that blow, carrying with them gifts, in other words. Verily, expose yourselves to them. Okay, and so this is one of the ta'arrud to the nafhat is going to the hadra. Part of exposing yourselves to this is to go to the hadra. And the dhikr itself, and the qasidas, also there's a field, like a magnetic field, as it were, around the dhakirin of protection and of certitude. And of the, you know, perfections of the tariq. And for all of these reasons, you know, Sheikh Abdul Rahman, Sheikh Abdul Wakil al-Durubi, who is my Shafi'i fiqh sheikh, he was not a Sufi sheikh. He didn't miss a hadra ever until the illness from which he died. He wouldn't miss one. And it was the secret of, you know, part of the secret of his barakah. It's incredible, you know. He was incredible. I never saw anyone better. I never saw anyone who benefited from their fiqh more than Sheikh Abdul Waqil, of anyone I've ever seen, east or west. He never missed, and he was, you know, he's a faqih. You know, you ask him about any question, and he would say this and this and this and this and this. And you'd say, I would say, with my poor adab, I would say, well, is this what you say? Is this what you say, or is this in the books actually? And his ghira would come and switch on, and he'd go and he'd pull it out of the books, you know, right from where it was. You know, he never made up anything, and he said, I don't know. I never heard him say either. Never say him say, I don't know. Why? Because he spent his time for 34 years or 40 years instead of reading books of fiqh several hours a day, each day of his life. And he knew what was in them. He was like a super fiqh. And it was realized he was not a person of just call words, eloquent words, but rather he was a person of how.
And he was known in the tariqah, sorry.
Yeah. He was first in the tariqah Saadiyah. It's a small Syrian tariqah in Hems. He was from Hems originally. And his sheikh, he said, I'm going to... And I think he stayed in a while. He went to Zabadani first. And then he told his sheikh that he wanted to go to Damascus. And his sheikh said, well, you should... he says, no, you're no longer my murid. You should be the murid of Sheikh al-Hashimi. And so he went to Sheikh al-Hashimi. And he became a murid of Sheikh al-Hashimi. And he was always, what can you say? You know, you heard of somebody with a sort of a dry sense of humor or sort of a dry nature. He was absolutely, he was, you know, he was kind, you know, underneath it, but he was absolutely withering with anything that was against the Sharia. He was just, you know, absolutely, he didn't know the meaning of the word compromise. And he would go into a house and he would see somebody's grandfather on the wall, you know, a photograph. He would leave without another word. And so everybody just knew that that's the way he was. You know, pictures, as far as he was concerned, were completely out, completely haram. But he was, subhanAllah, he was a great faqih, and never, he didn't have the slightest bit. He was mutahakkak in the Sharia. If I wanted to point to one of the people who was an alim of Sharia that I would really, you know, really accept as an alim in Sharia, it's like Murabit al-Hajj and Hamza Yusuf, you know, someone who is mutahakkak, that Hamza Yusuf was really impressed by, and it was that the whole course of his life was changed by him. That's like Abdul Waqiyah was, you know. Sheikh Abdul Rahman, he was the faqih of Sheikh Abdul Rahman. Whenever Sheikh Abdul Rahman wanted to know anything in the Sheikh's lifetime, he was there with Sheikh Abdul Waqiyah after Salat al-Dhuhr every day. Without exception, Sheikh Abdul Rahman, our Sheikh, and the Tzawwaf, sat with him. And if we wanted anything about Sharia, he was the one. And I asked him once about Sheikh Abdul Waqiyah. And one of the things he said about Sheikh Abdul Waqiyah, he said, يجب اعتقادنا بولايته. Since it's obligatory for us to consider him one of the awliya. Okay. And he also said that Sheikh Abdul Waqiyah's knowledge is above the mufti, above a mufti. Level of knowledge itself. He was a real, you know, he was really, but also a person who, in the alim amal, you know, a person mutahakkak in the Sharia who practiced what they knew. Okay, and so this is, and he was a Sufi, you know, he was a Sufi. He was, but he was the fuqaha Sufiya, as the saying goes, or maybe the Sufi of fuqaha. I think this is the proper expression, the Sufi of the fuqaha. So that was, so the existence of people like Sheikh Abdul Waqiyah, and it's not just one person like that. The Hadra is filled with ulama. If you go to the Majlis Salat al-Nabi, you see the ulama of the Islamic society there. Okay, because they're not ignorant of the benefit of it. And so the Hadra is an act of worship, in other words. And those who say the contrary are mistaken. No, it's a mistaken ijtihad. But it's a fiqh difference between the people who say it. But in terms of tariqah, you have to have taslim. You know, if you don't have taslim, then you won't benefit until you do get taslim. Taslim meaning deference to one's sheikh. And our own sheikh, as I mentioned, one of the munshits, one of the singers of the odes at the Hadra, who, you know, deliver the qasidas and sing them for the people that are making the Hadra. And whoever would like the mashru'iyya or the legal validity of the Hadra to be expounded at greater length, look at the tariqah notes. It's a fairly complete thing. Also the Q News article about the whirling dervishes. So this is funny. It wasn't one of my least popular articles. Q News. الحمد لله رب العالمين.